listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web and your number one source for after-show entertainment. From the AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV's Penny Dreadful After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Penny Dreadful After Show.
All right, guys, welcome back to another week of the Penny Dreadful After Show. And thank goodness I am hosting, because the other three here on the panel with me are all taking selfies right now. You guys,
excuse,
put your phones
me?
Down. Don't
excuse
even act
me.
Like you
I was like checking my makeup.
Up.
Actually, 15 seconds ago, you were taking selfies.
But I okay. No comment. All right, let's just move right on from that so I don't look bad. Hey, guys, I'm Bobby DeMuro, and joining me, as always, Marisa Serafini, Roxy Striar, Tiona Hobson. Ladies, hello.
Hello, Bobby.
We are here for season one, episode three, Resurrection of Penny Dreadful, which is fast becoming like maybe our favorite show of all time. They mean business in this show, and Showtime's doing a great job, huh?
Ah, amazing, amazing. I mean, I love these stories because they're intriguing in and of themselves, but then how they're portraying it and having that little creative twist to on their end, it's really fascinating to watch every week.
I felt like I couldn't breathe for the entire episode.
Was that just because of the intro, the opening credits that you guys hate?
Or? No, I oh, love yes. the opening like credits. Those. I'm the one who doesn't want to fast forward through them, but that's because I'm weird and twisted. I think this episode, even though I thought episode one was great, episode two was fantastic, episode three knocked it, them all out of the park. It was unbelievable. I was so glued to the screen the entire time tonight. Everything was gorgeous, even though it was horrific. It was beautiful. Even if you aren't a fan of the show, which is impossible to me to think of that, but just watching it, it's so well shot that how could you not just be in awe? Oh, my jaw was like completely open.
It's like watching a feature every single week.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's unbelievable. The amount of thought and effort that goes into every single moment, incredible.
I love that they're not making us wait every week, you know, and it's not a normal network show where, right. you know, you have to wait each week. They don't answer anything. Like each week they're coming back and they're bringing something new, intriguing, and, you know, they're really getting us attached to it very
quickly.
Well,
they're only quickly. 8
episodes. Yeah, so it's like they're on it. They're Speedy Gonzalez right now.
Speaking of attached, I know our fans are attached because, guys, we want to thank you for 2 weeks in a row now. We are the number one show on AfterBuzz.
Guys, you're the number one dance.
Number one.
That is awesome. And that is not because of us. It's because of you. So thank you very much for downloading, for watching on YouTube, and for commenting and tweeting. How many people have reached out to us about this show? Awesome.
So many. Yeah.
Incredible.
So many comments on YouTube, too.
Yeah. And good stuff, smart stuff. It's not just us, but you guys are a lot smarter than we are. But let's get into the show now this week. And as we do it, if you haven't already, hit subscribe on iTunes and hit subscribe on YouTube and keep watching. I think a lot of people are finding us pretty easily, but if you have friends who like Penny Dreadful, tell them about the After Show, because we would love to have them in the fold and we would love to talk with everybody about this thing. Let's get into the first topic, though. Speaking of things new every week that we don't have to wait for, like you were talking about, Tiana, we learned something new this week, and we gave the creature who appeared out of nowhere from last week at the end of last episode, we gave him a name. It is Caliban. It's his nom de théâtre. It's his stage name. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about Caliban and Frankenstein. Let's start there. And starting with Frankenstein, we see a flashback at the very start of the episode when he was a kid. He was a weird kid.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say weird. I'd say he was definitely an outcast, but he was kind of like self-exiled, that he was so interested in science and life and how things work, which maybe on the outside, on the surface, people might read as weird. But
I don't mean weird like science. Science is not weird. It's cool. I mean weird like how many kids pontificate on death after their dog dies and talk about how poets view death. He's like, what was he, 10 years old at that point? That's like...
I think that what they're trying to do is make us feel for every single person on the show. So we're going back and we're seeing what happened with him. He loses everything and everyone he loves. And now some of the actions he takes, we might not appreciate. We might not do the same thing, but we understand where he's coming from. And that's why, you know, call him weird or don't call him weird, whatever you want. But these are the facts. This is what happened. This is when he lost his dog. This is when he lost his mom. You know, all of these things that we're seeing, and we're understanding who he is and why he's interested in the things he is.
Yeah, because in the Frankenstein story, like, having seen the loss of his dog, that's what really got him interested in life and death and just that the whole meaning of everything and what keeps people or things alive. That's where it, that spark in the catalyst that gets him on the scientific path that he goes on.
That was way harder for me to get through than the opening credits with the maggots out of the eyes of the dog. How long has that dog been sitting there? And
why did he just find the dog?
Why did he just find it? At least a week.
It's okay, Roxy. Have another drink. It's okay.
It's over now.
They have gin in my cup.
Take a sip of that gin.
I really appreciate you guys out there for appreciating my gin love. Thank you once again. Yep.
Necessary on this show. So let's keep talking about Frankenstein, though, because flashback aside, he loses Caroline. Was Caroline...
His mother.
Okay, that's what I thought. Yeah. So he loses Caroline, and to your point, he loses everything around him, and we're establishing his backstory and his loss and his sorrow and heartbreak and why he's doing what he's doing and why he's doing what he's doing to create an immortal creature, a creature that cannot die because the things we've seen around him have died.
Right.
So he's trying to take care of that problem in a way. But we go to the scene that we were left with at the end of episode 2 when the firstborn confronts him. At this point, we only know the firstborn as creature and not as Caliban, as we will later. That's a great scene to me, looking at how the firstborn lived, and I will admit I'm wrong. There's a first for everything.
We were both wrong about this.
We were totally wrong. He didn't come from inside Proteus. He came from somewhere behind him. I still don't understand where, but he came from behind him.
It looked like just there was just a little, like, what was it called?
An alcove? I don't know. It's not the right word, but there was like a little cave area.
Like if you were a kid, it's definitely where you would have hid during a hide and seek game.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's where he was hiding and he popped out.
Well, a lot of buildings and houses and stuff in England and in the European areas, they have spaces underneath stairwells. So it makes sense that he would probably be hiding under a stairwell.
I'm telling you guys, Professor Serafini, last week it was history. This week it's architecture. It's Victorian London architecture. She knows everything.
Well, she's an expert.
Speaking of Professor Serafini, I'm just curious how you guys felt because I briefly got Marissa's take on this. But for me, somebody who's very new to these Penny Dreadful stories, I am glued to this. I don't know the background of everybody. I'm watching this. Everything is new information. I'm loving it. I'm eating it up. But Marissa walked out and said, wow, I feel like I already knew a lot of that. Do you feel like even though that was the case, it was necessary to put it in for the people like me who aren't as well read as you are? Or do you think that we should maybe be catering to audiences that know their stuff?
Absolutely, because I feel anyone who has read the Frankenstein, they would have expected this type of creature for the first creature that we saw with Proteus. And then when we find out that Proteus was the more subdued, more empathetic kind of creature, we're like, okay, it's not as gritty as we thought it was. And then we see this monster, the firstborn, with the expected storyline that anyone who knows the story would come to know. So I like how they're going back, be like, no, we thought it was one way, but it is actually this way.
So different variations on the story, so we need to know exactly what story they're going with.
Yeah, I think that it's very important for new people to learn about it. But I felt like this episode, I thought maybe too much time was spent on it, just for me. I thought that maybe we could have cut out a little bit of like the Frankenstein story to focus on something else, because to me it just drug out a little bit, and maybe that is because I'm just more familiar with the story. Yeah. So I didn't feel like I was learning anything new.
Okay.
See, and I'm on Roxy's side. I'm on your side because I didn't read Shelley and Dorian Gray as much as you have and haven't read it
Why
as
not?
Recently as you have.
You don't have that on your bedside table?
I surprisingly don't.
I mean, I do.
So, but because of that, Roxy, I'm with you that I like seeing this establishing thing, and I think at the end of the day, whether it's us who are relative newbies or it's you two who are relative experts in this or whoever it is viewing at home, or relative who are more comfortable with the story. At the end of the day, it's how do they take creative license to maybe straddle the fence between the two and do something new for you guys who know everything, but also tell the story and give it justice for Roxy and I who may not know it quite as well. And so episodes, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 are going to be interesting in how that they can straddle that line and give their own unique artistic flair to it while still honoring these stories that have been around for hundreds of years and deserve to be told in a certain way.
Absolutely. I mean, Tiana, I kind of agree that they did drag out Frankenstein a little bit only because you and I are more knowledgeable of the story. But I felt like if they didn't take this time to build this monster, he's not going to be as important in the future. So we have to build him now because he's going to be more relevant in more episodes to come.
It's also crazy for me because I, I'm not as knowledgeable about this, so I don't know if this is the way the books are. Maybe you guys can tell me, but I, going into this, was like, all right, Victor's amazing. I love him. He's a perfect human. And this monster, this creature, is a mess. And why is he coming back? Why is he tearing everything apart? But when we go back tonight, I'm melting for him. I feel gut-wrenched, devastated, whatever it is you want to call it. I'm looking at the way that he was left, his first interaction, the way he's describing it all. And I can't even believe that Victor would do this to something, especially after everything he went through. It's just, you know, some people go through horrific experiences and they come out and they're better and they're bigger. And some people, it completely crushes them. And I feel like he's straddling the line between those two things right now. Is he a good guy? Is he a bad guy? I really don't know. But I know that I'm on team creature.
Yeah. Well, I like how Penny Dreadful's showing like the two sides of, you know, Victor's story and then the monster story. Because in the actual book, because we see the two different stories. We focus on Victor for a long time and see everything that's happening with him. Like he's losing family members. And then we get his perspective. And then we take a humongous shift and go to the creature, the monster, and see all of his backstory. So we get these two separate stories, but in the end, they all merge together and make sense in how they line up with each other. So Penny Dreadful is kind of doing it like that.
Okay.
So I will say in the book, I think I felt worse for the creature than I did for Victor.
And now?
Yeah.
And now I don't know, I kind of still like Victor.
Yeah.
Because I really liked him in the first two episodes, so I don't know, I had a harder time hating him like I hated him in the book when I read it.
You didn't feel for Victor, or feel for the creature, excuse me, watching that scene where he describes the sheer abomination and the agony.
Yeah, yes, I definitely felt for him, but I'm saying in the book, I was totally 100% team creature. And watching tonight, I was like, oh, but I still kind of like Victor. That's like, exactly. I'm like, what kind of person am I right now? Like,
no, I'm with you. That's the exact problem I'm having. I don't know right now, because they hate each other so much. When Victor turns to Calvin and says, I could never love you, I'm thinking to myself, that is the worst thing you could ever say to somebody. How brutal and cruel of a human being do you have to be to say that?
I don't know if it's brutal and cruel, though. Does Victor hate Caliban, or is Victor so ashamed that he failed with what happened with Caliban that for his own personal psychology, he can't bear to face it, and he doesn't want to love him or even acknowledge him because it causes Victor too much pain? I don't know if it's hate as much as it's maybe self-hate or shame, and Victor says, this is more casual than it is, but Victor says, I can't even deal with you right now. It's one of those.
Right. I don't think it's the fact that he failed. I think it's the fact that he ran out. You know, so like you're saying, that shame, that's the word that sticks with me, because he did this, he created this, and we see it comes full circle at the end of the episode, which we'll get to more, but when he says, just so you know, we are now responsible for this thing downstairs. This is our responsibility. And it's him realizing he needs to take ownership of the things that he does and creates.
And I also see it as, you know, Victor, when he created this first creature, he was young. He was scared. You could see that he was scared. He didn't know what he had created. He didn't know what was going to happen. So in that sense, I also see him running away out of fear, like, of the unknown. He didn't know what was going to happen. The second time around, he had a better idea of what to expect. So that's why he wasn't as quick to run away from it as well.
And also, Victor, when he first ran out, he ran out willingly, because he didn't take that time and effort to get to know his own creation, his own monster. So, and I can understand why people would feel for the monster, because the monster is technically a baby, is completely innocent, has no knowledge of the world, and he's off to fend for himself. And then when you see someone who's very capable of having human emotions and know what's right and wrong and have that consciousness, but deliberately leaves the monster, you're going to feel more for the creature, because he can't help it, but Victor could have.
Marisa, that's spot on. And also on top of this, the fact that when we see the creature interacting with Victor, he's not trying to hurt him. He's begging for help. He's, you know, we do see his claw at the arm a little bit, but it's not because he's trying to cause pain or inflict pain. He's like, help me. I'm in so much pain. Help me. So I was kind of figuring we were going to see him attack or something that would make Victor run away. But no, it's just this thing that is in so much pain and is begging to be helped, and Victor just walks out on it.
But I don't see it as Victor just walking out. I see it as him being so afraid, because he does not know what's happening.
Of course he's afraid.
So I don't look at it as him just walking out on the creature, which, I mean, he could have gone back at some point, but we're all young. We all make mistakes. We all do stupid things.
This is a big one.
And this is a big one. I mean, it's like having a baby and then walking away from it. But,
yeah.
I mean, but in this day and age, I just don't... I see both sides, but I also see that, like, him being so afraid and not knowing what to do, that the only thing he knew to do was to run away. Just like the creature only knew to, like, scream and yell, but the way he was going about it was scaring Victor. So they're both equally afraid in that moment,
mm-hmm.
and they reacted in different ways,
right?
Which caused them to be separated. But I don't think it makes someone less of a, like, nice person or anything. I think that Victor's reaction was very human in that moment.
I get what you're saying, but, you know,
it was, but about, Victor didn't choose to go back to his creature. He just left him.
Right. Absolutely. And we're talking about, it's similar to having a baby and walking away from it. You know, the woman who had the child and then put it in the toilet seat and, you know, and then says that she didn't expect it to die. That's what I think of, you know, how could you, Victor, expect anything good to happen? You know, if you leave, something bad is going to happen. There's no way you leaving could cause more good than harm. You know, there's no way. So I feel like to never go back and check, to move, to live all these years. And like the monster says tonight, what did you think happened to me? Did you think I would go away? What did you honestly think? Maybe he did.
Maybe he thought he was going to be born with, you know, knowing how to speak and stuff, because, or, you know, knowing life skills, because technically it was a person at some point, mm-hmm. who's been put back together. He didn't know that this creature was going to be born and need to be taken care of and taught like a child.
Just clarification, and this could be a very ignorant comment on this, but when he says that it's his younger brother, he means just because they have the same father, right? Not because in real life they had been...
Yeah, and Proteus came after.
Oh, man. I'm going to get eaten alive for that one, guys.
It's cute.
I should have asked you after the show.
It's okay, blame the djinn. Hey, let's move on with Caliban, though. The creature, when he gets his name Caliban, how about the theater with him?
Love the theater.
Vincent reminds me a little bit of Lyle, where it's this very sinister, weird show, dark show, and then there's this one guy who stands out because he's kind of funny and different. But Vincent kind of takes the creature, takes Caliban under his wing, brings him to the theater, and Caliban learns early in his life that everybody is hateful and mean, and he gets beat up and kicked around. And then Vincent shows him acceptance and shows him love. And one question I have in the theater, because they haven't gone to it yet and they haven't alluded to it any more than a single line, but Caliban has the woman in the theater he's been eyeing, mm-hmm. he's got his buddy Vincent, and then he's got the lead male actor, the good-looking male actor, who Caliban has said doesn't like him. So conflict is coming in that theater, and that flashback, we will see what happens, whatever, but life is better for Caliban, but it is not rosy in the theater. And he's still, during that time, searching for Victor the entire time.
Yeah, and he even said during that whole realization that still he's in a place where he likes to be, but other people are still not going to accept him for who he is. So he learned that he has to hide in the shadows, even at the theater. And also, just a side note, the theater that they build, the Grand Grinnell, that's actually a real place, based on, but the set that they made, that's completely built just for the show. The whole theater from the ground up is completely handmade just for the show.
Wow.
I mean, we saw a little bit of it, but I'm sure there's going to be more episodes where we go, like, see all the floors and levels. Yeah. But, like, just down to the very details, the bricks in the basement and then the scaffolding up top, just everything was built just for this show.
And I know you know this, Marisa. We were just talking about this off air, but they mentioned in the theater in that scene that they are performing Sweeney Todd.
Yeah.
Right.
Sweeney Todd, which we know today, the feature film, the Tim Burton film or whatever, that was one of those first Penny Dreadfuls. I think it came out in like 1845 or something.
Yep.
That was well-known. A Penny Dreadful. So it's kind of a cool homage to the past to say, hey, this is why our show is named this. Here's another little connection for you history buffs, and let's move on.
Yeah, it's really cool, especially when we see, we know immediately when we see the throat being slit.
Oh, yeah, you knew it was Sweeney Todd.
And then also that reference to Ibsen, that was just hysterical. But it was actually really funny because I always think that Vanessa's character is literally Hedda Gabler. Like, it reminds me to her too. So that was a weird little moment also.
And also just Caliban, the name, because we know it's from Shakespeare's Tempest, but it makes sense with what's going on with this monster, because Caliban's character was forced to be in servitude and was deformed in a way. So it was always played by a monstrous kind of looking character.
And both the brothers ended up being named after Shakespeare characters. Yeah. Because Proteus was true. Shakespeare as well.
Shakespeare. Guys, he has the most beautiful eyes, though, the monster. I don't know how they did that, but I'm like, I don't think he's so bad. I could totally fall for him.
Is that the gin?
That's
talking?
Your type?
No, I'm not kidding. And he's so.
Do you prefer him with the blood all over his face and hands, or without it?
Just so you know, everyone loves a lost cause. Okay, get over yourself. No, I don't know. I'm looking at him like, I could be your person. Like, where are you? Don't you feel bad?
I've been rendered speechless by Roxy Striar.
Oh, guys, come on. Okay.
I can feel for the monster because all he wants is love.
Yeah.
I mean, don't we all? Doesn't want that?
I can feel for him. That's empathy. You've got like some weird crush going on. That's totally different. Those are two different emotions.
Whatever. I'm weird.
Maybe mine's more rational.
Maybe the monster's on Tinder.
Oh, let's find him.
I have said I am off of Tinder now. We can move on.
Step too far.
I'm deleting it.
I will say that him kind of hanging out in the theater in the shadows and stuff, that also really reminded me of Phantom of the Opera.
Yes, and so
I was kind of hoping, I was like, oh, they're going to burst out in song like the Phantom of the Operas. No one else wanted to join him on that.
No,
thanks, guys.
Totally nice voice.
Totally,
I was surprised.
Left me hanging.
Continue singing. Nice voice, yeah.
No, said no one ever, anyway. Bobby.
No, I was being honest. Maybe we'll take a Twitter poll later. Let's keep talking about Caliban, though. One quote I have written down made me strong and tireless. If only you had made me handsome. So Caliban, to me, really wants to be... I don't even think the handsomeness is the specific issue, but he just wants to be accepted and normal. And that goes back to the love idea that he wants love. But it's not just love from a woman. That's his main goal, as we find out in a second. I think it's also just acceptance into society, because remember, when he was up in that loft after Victor Frankenstein left, he studied society from afar for a long time through the window. He read through books to learn how to read. Like, he's paid his dues. He got his graduate degree in life in a weird way. You know, mm-hmm. He School of Hard Knocks or whatever. But now he wants to fit in society. And that's a big thing for him, is he wants to be normal. He doesn't want to be a monster. He doesn't want to be a creature. He doesn't want those scars to dominate who he is. He's looking to be normal. And part of that is the love, the woman.
Right, I think he's feeling confused, though, because when we first see him tonight and he's talking, he says, look at this face. Is it not well made? So he knows from society that they think he's hideous. But when he thinks about himself, he feels like everybody else. And so he's human. He's got skin. He's got eyes. So I do think he feels confused about what he is supposed to look like, or how people view him versus how he views himself.
He's definitely confused with humanity and society and themselves. But like, you can see he's learning to love people and like what they do. And he's becoming fascinated by people's behaviors and all their actions and stuff. Because he even said from the theater, even though these people were acting and that was fake, they were creatures of perpetual resurrection, hence the title. I thought that was brilliant. They're just people, you know, going through all these motions, but then doing it again. And he finds the beauty in that. So,
and he mentioned something along that lines, that the woman gets killed every night at the theater, only to not die, and she's back the next day. And he said something like, you know, hey, just like me.
The undying.
Exactly.
Just like me.
Yeah. He sees that in himself.
Now, last thing with Caliban before we move on, and I know you want to get to that sex scene with Josh Hartnett,
yes,
Roxy,
please.
So we're just going to let
Tiana was the one talking about it. I didn't even say anything. Guys, we're getting a bad rap here.
That was me this week.
The gin side of the table wants to talk about that sex scene. Last thing.
Hey. Oh, we'll take goodness. It. We'll take it.
Last Every thing episode. With Caliban. Marisa, let's just do this, you and I.
Okay.
Last thing with Caliban. In the marketplace, when he walks Victor Frankenstein to the market, asks specifically about the companion. You guys all reacted very, very like gasp and shock and moaning and stuff when he said to Victor, you know, I want love or whatever. And Victor said, I could never love you, because we all knew it wasn't about Victor. Mm-hmm. But is Victor really that dense to say that? Or does Victor just not want to maybe broach that conversation that Caliban has, that, hey, you need to go get me a companion? And Victor obviously doesn't want to do it, but didn't even want to talk about it.
No. Didn't even want to look at him.
Yeah.
I think Victor's very vain, and I think he thought that they were talking about Victor.
So you took it at face value?
Yeah,
then,
I absolutely did. Because I don't think Victor was trying to brush under the rug. He knows that it would have been brought right back up, which bothered me a lot about Victor. Again, I am still with Tiana a little bit, that I like Victor. I really like Victor. But this moment, to me, was showing that he is, you know, earlier in the episode, the monster says to him, who's the child, you or me? And I'm kind of starting to see that it's Victor, and he has a lot of growing to do.
But just to play a little devil's advocate here, the creature, or Caliban, also says earlier in the episode that, like, he hates humans, pretty much, and that, you know, they aren't capable of all these things, and, you know, just, he doesn't like human beings, and he has that prejudice against them. So when he brings up love, why wouldn't Victor think that he's thinking of the love from a father or a parent and not the love of a woman if he said that he didn't like humans and that we're incapable of all these things? So I think Victor's reaction, that might have been mine.
Right.
Thinking, well, not, I wouldn't have said I could never love you. I'm not that rude. But I would have thought he was talking about, you know, the way his story was all setting up to someone who's just listening to this guy talk, and he's like, I mean, there's one thing I don't have, and there is love.
And it's hard for Victor to probably love this monster right now, considering the monster just killed his nice creature, Proteus, mm-hmm. that he grew to kind of love within mm-hmm. that one episode that they had. So, like, I can understand why Victor's saying, I don't want to love you right now, in paraphrase.
Yeah, plus in every romantic comedy, guys, back to this, the guys always don't want to love the girl at first, and then eventually, you know, by the end of it, they love each other, because then you get to know each other. Like, they don't know each other at this point, so how could
he
love? How could he love someone that just killed someone he loves?
Right, of course, but I think saying it is a different thing than feeling it, and I really believe, T, if somebody brought you somewhere to show you something, you wouldn't be thinking about yourself. I think it's very vain. If somebody brings you somewhere to show you something, to not look around, open your eyes, and at least question, where are you getting love from? You wouldn't just say, from me, you know, you wouldn't assume that. I don't think most people would assume that. I think that Victor is very focused on himself, because he's had to be, because nobody else was looking out for him for so long. So he is focused on him, which is, as we see from his past, valid. But what did you guys think about this line? He says, you threaten me with death. If you seek to threaten me with life. Dots. I really don't even know what
I think that makes sense with Victor, because he's fascinated by death, but he wants life for everything that has died, because in the story, a lot of people die in Victor's life, and if he could do anything to bring people back, he chooses life over death.
I think too, and not to fall too far off the actual story, but to me, Victor has had so much death in his life that mm-hmm. we've seen in the flashback today, and what is he doing? He's not going to the bar and making friends. He's not going and falling in love with human women. He's creating monsters to live immortally, to on some level be his companion, as we saw with Proteus, to be his companion of some sort, whatever the end goal was going to end up being with Proteus that didn't happen. So Victor has obviously a little bit of a skewed view of the world, but a normal person in that sense might say, if I want love, if I want companionship, well, I'll go, you know, wherever you could get that in the 1880s in London.
Find a Brona.
Victor's creating monsters. So to him, maybe life, I don't know if it scares him or if he's completely given up on life. And he says, I deal with death all the time. I'm, you know, putting the undead back together. And, you know, what do I care about death? You show me life and love and loss and things like that. That's what I can't handle, because I had to handle it in the past and I didn't cope with it so well, or I'm still struggling.
Ooh, fire answer.
I guess.
No, I think it's a really good point. In a way, Victor and the monster are looking for the same thing. They both want somebody who's going to be there forever, clearly. So they might find that in each other, or they might not. That's all I got, guys.
Hey, speaking of forever, let's transition, because I can't wait to talk about Josh Hartnett's butt.
Oh my gosh, guys.
You and T both.
That was a joke. I can wait to talk about it, but I'm going to acquiesce to you guys. We see the sex scene, a very extended sex scene, I guess, for television, at least what I'm used to. But hey, it was pretty decent.
Oh, it's so Showtime-esque.
It was very sensual.
I loved the difference
okay.
Look at them. I love the difference between this interaction with this woman, Brona, compared to his first interaction with a woman who he just, like, had a nice quickie and tossed her aside.
The blonde girl at, like, the fair.
Yeah, at the fair. So it shows that in this lovemaking scene that Josh Hartnett, Ethan, that Ethan really might actually care for this person.
I think that you can also say that with Brona. Last week we saw her with Dorian, and it was very rough and rugged and That was still hot. But this week, you know, we see them in like a much more like softer, gentler type of way. And, you know, there's a lot of.
Well, Marissa said it, lovemaking.
Yeah.
It was lovemaking. It was lovemaking. They weren't screwing. They were making love. And we were watching it, and it was beautiful how much he cared about her. And the back-to-back scenes of him knowing she needs money and then him going to get the money. Mm-hmm. We know that this is a different kind of thing for her. But this is different for him, I mean. But I'm wondering, when finally we hear Vanessa say, everyone loves a lost cause, is this something that he does? Is this who he is? He fights for things that are already almost gone too far.
Listen, let me play devil's advocate on Ethan Chandler, because the first couple times we've seen him having sex, it was very casual. He knew it wasn't a commitment, so it's easy to get out of. When you don't know the girl's name, you're probably not getting engaged. If he knows, obviously, that Brona has consumption, and he knows what that means, money or not, medicine or not, he knows what that means, and it is a lost cause idea, that's an easy out for him. And he says, hey, I can have these feelings of love, and I can quasi-commit to her. I mean, I'm putting motives on him that may not be true, but I think it's like, I can quasi-commit to her, and this looks great, and she'll love me, and I like her, and I like being around her, so let's, you know, do whatever, knowing in the back of his head, I'm not in this forever. She's gonna die.
Well, why does he want to get her the medicine, then?
I think because he is a nice guy, and he does like being around her, but I think even in the back of his head, he's saying, not that this is as temporary as some of his other situations, but this is not, he's not looking at, you know, a lifelong love here.
But the job he just committed to get the money for her to get medicine, that's a freaking weird job.
I think because he's an honorable guy. And so there's this dichotomy for him of being an honorable guy who does like being around this girl. He's not casual with her and doesn't care for her. He cares for her, but there's a difference between caring for somebody and loving somebody in that regard and wanting to actually spend your life and commit the rest of your life to that person and go the extra mile. And I just don't think he's going to go the extra mile knowing he can get out of it so easily with her health.
See, I don't think that he would risk his life and make all this money in order to keep her alive longer if he didn't want to commit to her. I think that this is the girl that changes him. I think this is the different one.
This is the game changer.
Yeah.
Okay, well then let me ask you a different question. Does he change her? Because she's still working.
I don't know yet. I think we're going to have to see. I think that if he can provide her with money, she's not going to be working. I don't think that she's working because she loves it. I think she needs to feed herself is what she says tonight. So if she has feelings for him the way that I think he has feelings for her, then I believe he'll be making the money and she'll stop working. Or she'll die. Because I'm not saying that him getting her the medicine is going to work. Maybe he can't get it in time. Maybe even if he gets it, it's...
Maybe she's too far
gone. I just think
that
if he needed a way out, he wouldn't be trying to help her get medicine.
Right.
Because that's his way out, is her dying. So why get her the medicine and why do such a dangerous job when he could easily go back to gunslinging and whatever he was doing before?
Why do you take him at face value that he's getting her medicine? He never confirmed it verbally with her. Yeah. She just said she needs medicine, didn't have money. He kind of looked at her, and then the next scene is him going in for the job.
The reason I do is because I don't think he needs money. I don't think that he needs money right now for anything else, unless something is being hidden from us, which is very possible. We know he doesn't want to go back to America. His father's been calling, trying to get him back. It's something about the law there. Maybe he'd be okay, maybe he wouldn't. He seems to be living a completely comfortable life. He drinks when he wants to drink. He has sex when he wants to have sex. He has no problem with the ladies. So what else would he need this money for? Because I can't say an answer, it definitely has to be this. The way they set up the scenes back to back like that, they're trying to prove something to us. And either they're trying to blindside us, so you could be right, or they're showing us this is what he's doing.
So you guys are telling me that next week on the show, Ethan and Brona will register at Bed Bath & Beyond for the engagement and the wedding, and then they will take engagement headshot photos with a photographer.
Target more.
Oh,
but,
okay. Yeah.
Yeah. For a limited time only at Bed Bath & Beyond and Target, you can get 2-for-1 headshot wedding photos.
Okay. Steven. Wait, where's our product placement, though? We need, like, something on the table now.
Hey, no, Target's a good call because you can get everything there.
Yeah, I love Target. Yeah.
Oh, my God. Target, the best.
Target.
All right.
Digress.
Move on. Target, okay, well, free press.
Let's get off of Brona. I don't know if there's a whole lot more on Brona right now, but there is a lot more to talk about with Mr. Chandler, because he then goes, after the scene with Brona, after the sex scene, he goes to Vanessa and Malcolm's crib, as the kids say.
The crib.
And in asks for a job. They say, oh, it's...
Picture it on cribs, like... Sorry, that was the weirdest way of phrasing it.
Again, she's drinking gin. Yeah.
That was a delayed reaction.
Cribs, like Pimp My Ride, Cribs, MG, whatever.
No, we get it.
Pad. It's called a pad in Europe. Come on, guys.
Okay, moving on. So they go to he goes to Malcolm Murray and Vanessa's mansion. Is that better?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Their palace.
Okay, he goes to the palace and he asks for a job. They say, oh, fortuitous timing, we have a job for you. And he doesn't care what it is, to your point about needing money for possibly Brona. But the issue here is they go to the London Zoo. And there's a bit of a trap set that we learn later in the London Zoo, because apparently Mina is not as involved as maybe we thought she was, or her disappearance is not quite as important as we thought it was. It may actually be about Vanessa, like Malcolm says. Is Malcolm telling her the truth now? Because he wasn't at the first place about going to the zoo. Is he telling her the truth about being...
Right. Well, we hear the story last week where Malcolm finds out that this could be about Vanessa, and he's told not to tell Vanessa because who wants to know they're being hunted by the devil is pretty much what the story is. So we heard that whole conversation. Everything we heard in that conversation is now been told to Vanessa. The conversation could have been longer. There could have been multiple conversations. We know as much as Vanessa knows. You know, there isn't anything that he hasn't told her that we know.
But even before we go to the zoo, we see Vanessa in that hallway, and she hears all these animals. And we hear, like, the lion, falcons, tiger. So all these jungle type of animals, right. Which is interesting because, you know, Sir Malcolm, he's an African explorer. He probably knows his way around a jungle, too. So, and then to go to the zoo, the only place close enough to them that would have all those type of creatures, I thought was cool.
Yeah, it really was. It was smart, but what do you guys think about, so we see but Mina.
I don't think Sir Malcolm's telling the whole story here. Not to Vanessa, at least.
Okay.
Because even some of the information that we found out last week, I mean, he didn't tell her about, you know, the whole Amun-Ra and, like, the devil coming after her. He just said, I think that, you know, whatever we're seeking is maybe seeking you.
We see that Mina now has approached Sir Malcolm and Vanessa in some capacity, but they were very different, or at least in the way that they were shown to us, where Vanessa, there was almost time stop. She was dropping the cup. The cup is in midair. Mina shows. What did you guys think about that, the way that she heard these animals and all this started to happen?
Yeah, I love the contrast of these two, because with the first appearance of Mina with Sir Malcolm, it looked like Mina was going to attack Sir Malcolm in a very angry, vengeful way. And then with this one with Vanessa, it was more of a plea to, like, a kind of
help
desperate
me.
Kind of situation. So it makes, just seeing these two, makes me think that Sir Malcolm was more involved with her death in a more dirty way, I guess you can say, or more hurtful way than Vanessa was.
This is what she says. She says, they are all about me, the beasts that feed at night, and they are hungry. If they're all about her, then how could they be about Vanessa?
No, all about her in English sense, not an American sense. All about, all around.
Oh, they're all about me. Okay, got it. So what does that mean then? They're all around her. What are these beasts? Is it the same thing that we see tonight that we capture, or?
And it's also the line, I'm hungry. I mean, go back to the very first episode when Vanessa's praying and says, soon, child, soon, I'm hungry.
Yeah.
Is it the same beast? Or beasts, plural.
Right.
Yes?
No? I don't know. I'm not sure the answer.
I'm just waiting for the next episode. Maybe they'll tell me.
I need to be
good
told.
Good one.
I just need to be told what it is.
So let's talk zoo, because they get there and they end up dealing with the wolves. In that regard, with the supernatural thing, because Vanessa had the supernatural experience the first time, obviously, when Mina was there. That was not real. Vanessa imagined it or whatever was going on in her head. Are those real wolves? Like paws and claws and fur, is there something supernatural with those four wolves and just the entire group saw it?
Well, I mean, Ethan sure did know a lot about those wolves,
right?
And
yeah.
What to do in the situation, and maybe they are supernatural. I mean, there was a lot of talk on YouTube about maybe Ethan being supernatural, maybe him being a werewolf.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, when I saw that, I was like, this is him, like, he's a werewolf. Why didn't anyone ask him what the hell was up with that man? No one said, hey, dude, what the F was that?
My other question to get to the jungle related to this, why wolves? we saw lions and tigers and monkeys and falcons and all these kind of more rainforest jungle African animals.
Yep.
Wolves are not animals that you're going to find in the Congo. So why wolves for that scene? What's the significance of wolves?
Absolutely. When we see Ethan tonight too, he talks to Vanessa and she says, "Do you question that?" And he says, "No, that is something I do not question, that you have something else. You can see something else," which makes me think that he is part of her world in some sense. He has some supernatural thing to him, and it's only confirmed tonight when he puts his hand in the wolf's mouth and the wolf bites down but not hard enough to injure him. I mean, maybe it's werewolf, maybe it's something else, but you know, when we saw Vanessa the first episode, when she looks at that creature and it backs off, that was like this tonight with the wolf in the hand. So I don't know what they are, but they're definitely not just regular wolves, and or he's definitely not just regular human.
Or he's just an American guy who's got a good affinity for animals because he's an old Wild West guy fighting in the Indian Wars.
I don't think that's it. But maybe.
I mean, but have you ever seen Dancing with Wolves? Come on.
He's new Kevin Costner.
Marisa could have done the same thing, to be honest. No, I'm not going to lie. She could have put her hand out and the wolf would have been like, okay, you win. You win, ma'am.
Right, thank you, Roxy.
You're welcome.
Wolf woman.
I did mean that as a compliment. I did, for sure.
Thank you.
Wolf woman, one with wolves.
But yeah, I don't know the significance of wolves. Hopefully we'll see maybe the werewolf storyline come into play. That, I mean, that's dark and gothic as well. It would not surprise me if they brought that storyline in.
It wouldn't surprise me either.
I'm going to ignore Roxy like she didn't actually just howl.
wasn't that movie An American Werewolf in Paris or something? That's something, right? So maybe they'll leap over to Paris and then boom. He's the American werewolf, Paris.
We're getting dangerously into predictions right now. Stay on topic, you guys.
Sorry.
So from the wolves, we go from the wolves, and the next scene we see Fenton. We don't know his name is Fenton at that point. We learn it, you know, soon afterwards. The human, half-human, whatever he is, the supernatural being that looks like a human who is eating animal flesh, goes to attack Vanessa, and they knock him out and chain him up. Which one of you said you love his eyes?
I liked his eyes more than the creature's eyes.
His eyes were creepy as heck. They were neon.
No, they were just like that soft, greeny, light blue, like the sky above us on a nice, warm day.
Oh, I don't agree.
I also said that he looked like a coked out Peter Pan.
That I agree with.
Yeah.
That you were spot on about. I mean, that's absolutely his description.
But my thing is, like, we see him in our first interaction, he's chewing on some type of animal. Was it like the monkeys or whatever?
And he had chewed on an entire group of animals on the path.
Like, all these animals. Is he the one that's doing the killings from the previous episodes? We don't know.
Or is it his type? You know, he says he has a master, so I assume that the master has many of him or people like that, or not a man.
He's the master's minion. In a way.
Yeah, but I think there are minions.
He's definitely one of the minions.
Mm-hmm.
Master is in the dark behind you on the back of your neck. Don't you feel it? That was a very scary couple of lines for him, because we've all had like chills up our spine and things. Think you feel like a bug or something, you don't know what's there. It's that kind of a feeling where you know exactly what he's talking about. So who is Master? Is it the devil?
And then he ends up talking to the Master later, too. Yeah.
I don't think that the Master is the devil. I think that he is devil like.
I think the Master is Amun-Ra and Amunet.
Because he does mention Amunet and Amun-Ra.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. So I don't know exactly who's ruling him, but he says that the end result of this is that all light will end and the world will end in darkness.
Which is the...
Well, that doesn't
the world
sound
will
pleasant.
Live in darkness.
No, but that's the blood curse that they're trying to start. Trying to execute. Because with the end result of the blood curse, there's going to be darkness, the hidden ones will emerge.
But now they're doing testing on him, and they all decide to do that, which made me feel very uncomfortable, and I don't want to be a part of it.
I didn't agree with that part.
Yeah, it's awful. It's awful. They keep saying, this is a kid. He looks young. I don't know how young, but this is a kid. And it's, or even if you call it an animal, this is absolutely animal cruelty. Or human cruelty. I don't know what this thing is, but I feel awful for it.
Well, but I think it's significant, not only the testing thing, but the way that Malcolm Murray reacted, because for maybe the first time we really see Sir Malcolm Murray lose his composure, and he beats the guy and has to be stopped by Ethan. Remember in the seance, when the seance was going on, and Malcolm Murray was kind of being torn down in front of everybody for all these things with Mina and Peter, he sat there and took it, whether it was fear or composure or whatever, and he's a very together guy, because he should be. He's upper class and rich and whatever. He really lost it on this guy today, which to me shows that Malcolm Murray knows exactly how important this minion is and how important that master is, and he needs to know everything right now. But I think that's the desperation that you're talking about, which is why it's so unpleasant to think about how they're going to go testing on him. Malcolm Murray is he doesn't have many cards left to play.
No, right. And we saw in the first episode, Malcolm Murray said that he would murder the world to find his daughter. So right. He's at that point where he's just going to beat the living crap out of anyone to get information.
But I don't think that's the best way to go about it. I don't think this kid knows everything. No. I think he knows what he's been told, and I don't think he knows everything.
I don't think he's been told anything either. I think he's just one of, like we were saying, he's just one of the minions. He's just one of these people who was maybe at the wrong place at the wrong time and got turned into whatever he is now. And now he's just kind of scavenging around, and whoever the master is, maybe he has mind control and can, you know, like pop in and out of their minds and like feed them little information to know enough that, you know, I am your master, but nothing more.
But here's the thing too with Malcolm Murray. He lost composure so bad and beat this guy. We now have a good cop, bad cop situation, potentially, because Ethan could be a good cop, Victor could be a good cop, or maybe Vanessa could be a good cop. I don't know if she would get involved with what she knows. Yeah. But you have a good dichotomy where if they're going to question this guy, they've got him chained up. It looks like they're going to experiment on him. So it's like, let's see what we can get out of him, but you can do a dichotomy with Ethan being the good guy and Sir Malcolm Murray being the bad dude.
Ethan's the only one I see playing good cop. I don't see Victor playing that. He was very quick to jump on the let's beat this guy kind of page. But we find out no one in this room is kind. That's why we're here. That's what we've been told. I feel like I disagree a little bit. I feel like there's good in a lot of them. No, I mean, are we supposed to take that for what it is? Is Ethan not kind? He seems to be very kind.
But we don't know really his past. Heart.
I know we haven't gotten his backstory yet, which makes me scared.
We learn he fought in the Indian Wars.
Right.
By accident.
Right. Yeah.
Victor calls him out
that?
For it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. By accident. Which if we're operating under the fact that this is 1891, 1892, correct?
One of those years.
So
yes, early 1890s.
Well, let's think about this, because the Indian Wars, George Custer, General Custer in America, was not too many years before that. It was 10 or 12 years before that. I'm trying to think which Indian War it is. Because if he really did fight in the Indian Wars, which it looks like he did, we may be able to learn a little bit about Ethan's backstory without actually knowing about his backstory. So he was a frontiersman in the Great Plains, fighting in Indian wars with who knows what in America before he went to...
And you know what's also interesting?
Did you guys never take history?
No, but what's also interesting? Because in the first in the first episode, during his whole festival showdown, and he's saying the, you know, General Custard and stuff, and then Vanessa calls him out saying, you were too young.
Maybe keep the camera over there.
Maybe he wasn't. Maybe he wasn't actually telling the truth because Vanessa was saying that he probably wasn't.
Interesting. So it could be something completely different.
Yeah, it could be.
Yeah.
I'm going to do some research.
Hence why he could be a werewolf who never ages.
All right, you guys,
we know about doing research on the Indian Wars. Werewolves.
You two have homework this week. Yes, to learn about Custer's last name.
Do some research.
Okay.
Custer. How do you spell that?
C-U-S-T-E-R. It's interesting.
Okay.
I believe
Goodness.
You.
Okay.
I believe you.
Anything more on Vanessa and Sir Malcolm Murray before we transition out to news, or are we about there?
Get us with that news.
Goodness.
Let's do it. Let's do some news. We got Professor Serafini.
AfterBuzz TV News.
All right, so last week we saw the seance episode, and there's actually an interview with Timothy Dalton. He mentioned during the filming of the seance scene when, like, all the lights were out, and that one peaceful moment, there was a red admiral butterfly that just came fluttering by and just like sat on the table. And everyone was kind of freaked out. We were like, oh, it's a sign, especially during that scene. But the funny thing is that they were filming in the winter, and butterflies don't hatch during the winter, but the set that they were on, the atmosphere, they were using all the lights.
Oh, and crazy.
Because the set that they were currently on...
So it attracted the butterfly.
It because it's so warm that all the butterflies were hatching at that time, and during a time when they normally don't hatch. Mm. So having butterflies during the winter, during this type of scene, was kind of creepy.
And what do butterflies mean metaphorically?
Life, metamorphosis, things... going, it's a cyclical pattern.
Resurrection, a little cyclical thing. What was the title of this episode?
Resurrection.
Oh my lord.
Mind blown.
I think that was a little bit of a stretch, maybe.
Because that happened in the episode titled Seance.
Is there something in the gin today that's making you guys mean?
I'm just saying.
Maybe.
At least we're mean together.
Yeah, no, that's not better.
Okay, and then also Timothy Dalton talked a little bit about if the audience is going to find out more about the Vanessa or Sir Malcolm relationship. And he says, I can't really give that one away yet. Yeah, and he told Access that things with him and Vanessa are going to get complicated because they are a complicated pair. But we will find out more about them as the episodes come to fruition. And I thought that was cool because we really don't know how both of them really know each other, how they're involved. So we'll eventually find out.
Or what happened with Mina and Sir Malcolm.
Yeah.
And I wonder about that too with him and Vanessa, because just the faintest amount when Vanessa asks about Brona, when she asks Ethan who's the girl, just the faintest amount of just a little tension there between the two of them. So I wonder who Vanessa's going for.
I mean, you saw when Ethan agreed to do it, he looked at her and away from Sir Malcolm. Sir Malcolm was like, I'm with you.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. It's like, if Josh Arden said that to me, let me tell you. I'd be a happy girl.
And then Timothy Dalton also added that he loves working with Eva Green because he says, let me tell you, that girl Eva, I love her. I adore her. I mean, who wouldn't? She's amazing.
The best part of that quote that I saw too is she's so committed.
Yes.
Which is so, not only the seance, but everything. And that's what makes a great actor, period, is committing to what you're doing. Mm-hmm. But that's Eva Green in a nutshell.
And she's got a fantastic emotional intelligence and connection.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, Josh Hartnett spoke to Huffington Post Canada, and they questioned him whether, you know, working from film to TV is a big transition since it's been a while since Josh Hartnett has been on a television series. And he said his biggest fear was that he was worried about the other actors not being able to keep up with the television compact, condensed schedule, and that would like affect people's acting and performances and whatnot. But he loved the fact that he was working with John Logan because he believes John Logan has really adapted to television faster than most directors and writers would. And he was confident in John Logan that he agreed to do.
Wait, he said he was worried about the other actors?
Yeah, he was worried about like being with cast members that, what exactly did it say? Sorry, as I'm reading my notes. But just like working with cast members who might not know the television aspect.
I don't know. If I was a cast member and I read that, I think I would take that offensively. Like,
working with people who didn't have the energy and clout to continue making good material over the course of a long period of time.
On that note, and it's related to this quote, the writer, the creator of this show, created this thing and has been working on it for like 15 years.
Yeah.
This isn't like a one-year thing. This is a long-term project for him. So maybe that makes the transition easier for actors and crew members and whatever, because he really sees the bigger picture top to bottom because he's been looking at it for over a decade.
Yeah, and the funny thing, having John Logan like being writing these stories for so long, Ethan asked John Logan if he knew anything about Ethan's background, because the audience doesn't, and John Logan actually says he didn't actually quite know Ethan's background. So Josh Hartnett said that was a bit
disconcerting,
and not disconcerting, but a bit of a challenge for him working on a character that didn't have the background that he didn't know. So sometimes it was trying to kind of like just go with the flow with his character. And then also he asked, you know, working with Eva Green and Timothy Dalton, he says it's great working with both because Eva is a person who generally keeps to herself but works in a hard way to bring a lot of dark characters to the screen. And then in contrast with Timothy Dalton, that he's a theatrical background and is really experimenting with characters, and he can pull off different things within his character. So I thought that was interesting. And he also says about Timothy Dalton, he comes with that rich voice and strength of presence, and he grows to throw everything at the wall and see what sticks. So that's the kind of actor. Yeah, that's the kind of actor Timothy Dalton is and what he brings to his character.
I have a question for you guys on that note, because there's a lot of discussion about Eva Green and what she does and how committed she is and how talented she is. In your opinions, and we're going to open this up to the audience too at the end of the show, but in your opinions, who is the biggest star of this series, three episodes in? Who pops the most? Chandler, Vanessa, Malcolm Murray? What one character you say, wow, every time?
Definitely Eva. After that seance, Vanessa Ives. Vanessa Ives is just... That's all I think about when I think of the show. Like, that scene in itself was just so compelling, and she did such a great job in that, that in my eyes, she is, like, I will kiss her feet if she walked by.
And yeah, she definitely had a standalone moment for her character. But I think another person that always pops out to me is Victor, because we can see his emotional internal conflict within himself, and I find that fascinating.
I thought it was Protheus.
Proteus.
He was amazing, and I'm devastated to see him go. He did such a beautiful job without saying much. But I think that from the people that we're going to see more of, Dorian.
This is awesome. We're going to have four different answers on here. I am Team Malcolm Murray. That guy's got rage and then some more rage underneath it, and we've only seen a sliver of how much rage that guy has, and it's all coming out.
and just a quick thing, Josh Hartnett also appeared on Jimmy Kimmel this past week, yeah, obviously promoting Penny Dreadful, and he did a nice, fun game of charades with Charlize Theron. So it's really funny. Go check it out.
I want to see, you know how Jimmy Kimmel does the celebrities read mean tweets thing?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I want to see Eva Green read mean tweets.
Yeah, but the funny thing is, Eva Green doesn't have Twitter.
Yeah, I know.
She keeps to herself.
And so that's not funny.
But people are still tweeting about her.
She probably doesn't even get mean tweets.
But she's amazing.
She is amazing.
I mean.
Although I have seen some people say that they've seen her play a similar character before, so they wanted to see somebody else maybe give it a try.
She's talked about that, too, about how she'd like to play kind of a different character. But this is a lot of fun for her to do this.
But she's so good at it.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's so damn good.
Hey, okay. Guys, it's time for predictions.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
Don't look at me. I'm not starting. Because I ruined your prediction last week, Bobby. So you start.
Roxy, go for it.
Oh, geez. Just thrown under the bus. I'm predicting something with Dorian and Vanessa. There was definitely sparks there. We're seeing them together a little next week. I'm seeing some sex, some love, some drugs and rock and roll.
I love that.
I have a prediction. With this whole blood curse thing going on, if Amunet and Amun-Ra actually succeed in executing this curse and the hidden ones come from the darkness, who lives in darkness? Frankenstein. The creature lives in, comes from the shadows. So if this does happen, I think Frankenstein is going to play a big part in dealing with the defeating Amun-Ra.
Do you mean Victor, or do you mean the monster?
Yeah, Frankenstein, the monster.
The monster.
The firstborn. Or we can call him Caliban, whatever.
Caliban.
Marisa but says whatever.
I think, because he comes from the shadows, he comes from darkness. I think he can understand things that come from darkness, so he can fight them off.
So Amunet and Amun-Ra have an ally that they maybe don't realize they have yet, in Caliban.
Maybe.
And going off of that, Marisa, we did see in the preview for next week that when he's talking to Victor, Caliban does say, you know, he calls himself Victor's master. So there's kind of that going on. And we had, you know, the guy who's chained up tonight calling out for master. So I thought it was kind of interesting that they threw that one line in there of Caliban referring to himself as master.
Do we think Mina's like this boy that they have locked in the basement that they're looking for a cure for?
No.
Okay.
That's just me.
In a way, kind of yes, because both of these, this guy who's locked up and Mina, they live in the in-between right now because they're affected by good and bad. So they're transient right now. They're related in that way.
I don't really have a prediction, Bobby. Stop pointing at me.
You went off of Marissa's. I felt like that was fair. Okay. Right,
thank you.
Bobby, everybody point at Bobby now.
Marissa, I got a prediction.
Come on. Be on our team. Go ahead.
All right. And Roxy, I'm actually going to go off your prediction about Dorian. Sparks flew between Dorian and Vanessa. She's brushing her shoulders off. Spark flew between Dorian and Vanessa, but guess what? Dorian has had sex with Brona, and now Brona has had sex with Ethan, and Brona and Ethan, from what you guys are telling me, are in legitimate love, and I'm wrong about that.
So, I didn't say they're in love. Yeah, it's still kind of early to call it love.
Come on now. Okay.
They are in like with each other.
There's really a love square going on.
Did you guys want my prediction, or are we going to criticize my viewers?
We're just going to criticize you some more.
Okay, so my prediction is there's a weird love square, like Marissa, you're talking about. There's a lot of jealousy here because I think Vanessa's into Ethan on some level. Ethan's into her. Ethan's into Brona. Brona's had a thing with Dorian.
Seeing orgy.
No,
I'm seeing massive STDs.
I'm seeing way too much conflict between the four of them and the exact opposite of an orgy. I don't know what's going to happen, but nobody's getting any, and everybody of those four is going to fight. And honestly, I think something like that would bring down an Ethan-Vanessa relationship over Brona and Dorian in that whole situation, and it would maybe hurt what Vanessa and Sir Malcolm Murray are trying to do.
Oh, and also, I think Vanessa and Sir Malcolm Murray, their relationship's going to deteriorate a bit because seeing that Sir
secrets.
Malcolm will use her as bait against her will, Vanessa was not happy about that. So their relationship is definitely going to have some rifts in
turmoil.
That.
All right, guys, Twitter, Instagram, give us your names. We want you guys to talk to the fans.
Twitter and Instagram at the Tiona Hobson.
You can find me at Roxy Striar.
And you can follow me on Twitter and on Instagram at Serafini TV.
And I'm at Bobby DeMuro on Twitter, at Mr. Bobby DeMuro on Instagram, because it's formal. Instagram's more formal than Twitter. She's rolling her eyes, guys. That's it this week on the Penny Dreadful After Show. Subscribe on iTunes if you haven't already. Subscribe on YouTube and comment below and tell us the discussion this week for you guys on YouTube is which character pops for you? Who is your favorite character three episodes in? For the three of these lovely ladies, I'm Bobby. Good night.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here. And be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.